Last Lord's Day, we came to the end of John 1, and we're going to take a break from our series in John, pick up with John 2, God willing, next time, the wedding at Cana, Jesus' first miracle. So a great section that we have to look forward to. But this morning, I'm one that tends to believe that we ought to leverage the seasons, the holidays, the special events that are going on in our nation. I think we have opportunity to speak God's word into those situations when so many people are thinking about them. And so today is what? Valentine's Day. Valentine's Day. So I just want to talk to you a little bit about love this morning. And a message that is applicable wherever you are, married or not. Because in marriage, we see something greater than marriage. And so if I'm a single man, if I'm a single woman, I want to see marriage, but I want to see beyond marriage. The reason a single person ought to study marriage is because marriage is a picture of something greater. It is one of the pictures that Christ gives of His love, His sacrifice, His devotion to His church. And so whether I am a single or I am married, whatever my marital status may be, the gospel, this is one means that God preaches the gospel. Last Lord's Day, we had the Lord's Supper. Now, marriage is not an ordinance or sacrament of the church. We don't believe. There's some traditions that do believe that marriage is a sacrament. We don't believe it is a sacrament or ordinance of the church, but it is similar to the Lord's Supper in this way. The Lord's Supper proclaims the Lord's death till He comes. And Ephesians 5 tells us that the mystery of marriage is this. It is about Christ and the church. The Lord's Supper preaches the gospel. And so all of us are interested in hearing the message. And the same with marriage. Whatever our situation, marriage is to preach the gospel. It is to tell the story of Christ. And if you are married, your marriage is telling the story of Jesus. It's either telling the truth about Jesus or it's telling something different. Now, as believers, we want our marriages to tell the truth about Jesus so that all people might hear the gospel, so that they might see what is behind marriage, that they might better understand Christ and His church. For a number of years, Lori and I have had a heart for helping others, encouraging others, instructing others, counseling others in relation to marriage. It's something that we believe that will increase, God willing, as we get older together, as our marriage continues to deepen and ripen and we grow older together. We see ourselves more involved in that sort of work and in the future. It's a joy of our lives. Last week we had the opportunity to spend some time with a number of married couples and see various circumstances of life that they are in at the moment. We met a chaplain, an army chaplain, and his wife. 2 weeks ago, a little over 2 weeks ago, he thought he's about to be transferred to Fort Benning to be nearer to his wife's father, who is dying. But instead, his commander called him into the office and said, "I need you to go to Iraq 4 weeks from today." That was a little over 2 weeks ago. He leaves in about a week and a half. So that's pretty short notice. "I need you to go to Iraq." So life is changing for this couple. Godly couple, love each other. They just renewed their vows together in a sense, not in a formal ceremony, but he gave her a ring and they celebrate their 25th anniversary in a couple of months, but they recommitted to 25 more years together. But we were able to enter into their world a little bit and pray for them. I've been praying for them, and I've asked others to pray for them as well. So you pray for Chaplain Chris and his wife and family as he is about to head out. We're able to spend time with an older couple, both of whom lost their spouses. And one very suddenly, healthy husband seemingly, out on a boat ride, having a great day, dropped dead, just like that. No warning, no notice, dead. The other case, the man that she is married to now, his wife suffered from years for years with cancer, and she died. And so both of them, a widow and widower, in God's grace, met each other, have a joyful, happy, godly, contagious marriage. What an example they were to us as we spent time with them. And people all around, all over the spectrum, younger marriages, older marriages, coupled together, both had been previously divorced, now married to one another, trying to navigate through the brokenness of that. There's such a need, isn't it? We should pray, wherever you are in marriage, you should pray that God would strengthen the marriages that you know, that God would bless and help and use those marriages to display the gospel of Christ. Our world is broken. Our world is broken. You know, Justice Anthony Scalia died yesterday. And someone described it as sort of an Isaiah 6 experience, you know, where King Uzziah, who mostly had been a good king, and when he died, there was national grief as a result of that. There had been stability and strength with his reign. Yes, at the end, he had presumed upon God. He had been struck with leprosy. He had died, but overall, his reign had been a good one. And Isaiah went to the temple, and there he grieved, and there he met God. The earthly king was removed from the throne. He saw God upon the throne. Now, we look at Justice Scalia, then there are lots of things we might learn from his life, but one of the thoughts that came to my mind, thinking of Romans 1, is that I don't know all the details about his faith and whatnot, but I do believe that God used him as a restraining force in our country. You know, one of the mercies that God gives to a people often is he restrains evil from running its course. Sometimes he uses believers, sometimes he may use unbelievers to do that. And when God removes his restraint, we have a Romans 1 experience where there's a rapid decline downward. I know all of you, as Chris prayed earlier, concerned about our country. I mean, things seem to be spiraling rapidly downhill. And the Supreme Court is one example of that. And so as we think of it from purely human terms, we think, the worst time. I mean, that's our thinking, right? I mean, this could not have happened at a worse time in the history of our country. Some have called him the greatest Supreme Court justice in history, at least one of the greatest. So we think right here in the middle of an election year, plenty of time to name another Supreme Court justice, which would almost certainly be very liberal, very much to the left. And we have a justice who just died, who defended marriage between a man and a woman, defended life from the womb to the tomb, and that's gone. And we think the court has already shifted to the left. If there's another justice appointed before the next administration, then we are almost certain to see an even more rapid decline in our country. As Chris prayed too, I was struck by his prayer that even the most simple principles of morality are under attack in our culture. And the ancient institution of marriage is assaulted almost daily, or daily now in our culture. So I think when we are about the business of strengthening marriages and teaching the truth about marriage, then we are engaged in good work and gospel work, and I pray that all of us will be engaged in that at some level. So, let me just read a few passages. You can jump to Proverbs 5 if you want to as a launching pad, but I'm going to do something I don't typically do, more of a topical message this morning. Proverbs 5:18, and I want you to see in the verses that I read, I want you to look for sort of a key principle, a key word, a key thought that is similar in every one of these verses, and often missing in marriages, often missing. Proverbs 5:18, let your fountain be blessed and rejoice in the wife of your youth. Verse 19, be intoxicated always in her love. Ecclesiastes 9:9, enjoy life with the wife whom you love all the days of your vain life that he's given you under the sun, because that is your portion in life and your toil at which you toil under the sun. Song of Solomon 2:4, he brought me to the banqueting house. His banner over me was love. Sustained me with raisins, refreshed me with apples, for I am sick with love. You see a common theme or common thread running through those verses, and we could look at many others. It is the message of joy. It's the message of enjoyment. It's the message of being so in love with a person that you can describe yourself as being love sick or love drunk. The Bible uses that sort of terminology to describe this relationship. The Bible says that we ought to enjoy our spouse, that we ought to rejoice in our spouse, that we ought to be intoxicated with our spouse, that we ought to even be lovesick over the one that we are married to. And so a godly marriage rooted in Scripture, saturated with grace, is intoxicating, and it may produce love sickness, but as Ephesians 5 tells us, it is also a powerful testimony to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Man-woman marriage refers to Christ and His church. And so, again, if you are not married, see the beauty of the gospel. Look beyond the reality. You may long to be married, but just for a moment, look beyond, you know, the marriage ceremony and whether you'll be married or not. Look beyond all of that and see the generosity and beauty and kindness of God as He loves His church in such a generous, in such an intoxicating, in such a wonderful way. Marriage just portrays that. It's the marriage behind the marriage that we're to first of all be obsessed with, intoxicated with, and then whether single or married, we can bend that into our world. And if married, cultivate a joyful, happy, contagious, sweet-spirited, spiritually minded, love-sick marriage. If you are married, see the generosity of God and work on all of those things, because it is about Jesus. That's what your marriage is about. Now, who was this Valentine guy? Valentine was a Roman priest. He lived during the time of Emperor Claudius. Claudius persecuted the church, and one of the things that he didn't appreciate too much was young people getting married. And so Valentine secretly married young people in the church. He was caught. He was imprisoned. He was beaten, stoned, and decapitated. So you might say he lost his life over love. Promoting and encouraging the love of others. He knew, as the New Testament teaches, that it's false teachers who forbid marriage, but marriage is to be received with thanksgiving, the Scripture says, by those who believe and know the truth. You get to the Puritan era and you see that they railed against those who taught what they referred to as demon doctrines who forbid marriage. A gift from God. And so Valentine was martyred for his faith. It is legend has it, and there's a lot of confusion, a lot of mystery, and a lot of things we don't know about this character and other character named Valentine. But legend has it that his last letter was written to a young lady that he had prayed for, and she was healed before he was decapitated. And he signed the letter, "From Your Valentine." And so here we are, giving chocolate over St. Valentine's martyrdom. And Dr. Haken, who's a professor at Southern Seminary, says that the Valentine holiday originated as a Christian feast to honor Valentine, and He says as well, not much is known about him. He might be the conflation of two martyrs by the same name. But his association with romantic love comes in the Middle Ages with Geoffrey Chaucer. Some of you know him. He lived from 1343 to 1400. And he linked St. Valentine with romance, at least between birds, in his allegory, The Parliament of the Fowls. And so you can go, you can look that up, you can read Chaucer's work. And so in one couple of sentences from that, he says, where on St. Valentine's Day every fowl comes there, F-O-W-L, every fowl comes there to mate. So maybe that's where we get lovebirds, right? We talk about lovebirds. There's just a couple of lovebirds. Dr. Haken says, by the Victorian era, lovers were in the habit of sending each other homemade cards on St. Valentine's Day. The Puritans champion romantic love. If you, you know, you may have a lot of sort of preconceived notion about who the Puritans were, but I tell you what, you read their stuff on love, it'll make you blush. The way they wrote to one another and wrote about one another. One described his love for his wife as a burning fire of love. And that's where I guess Johnny Cash, you know, probably was influenced by the Puritans in that regard. And so they champion romantic love, and they counsel that marriage should be on the basis of love. And parents should not compel their children to marry when love was absent. And so, you know, history of arranged marriages, and we believe parents should be heavily involved in marriage and weddings and all that go along with that. But parents should not compel children to marry where there is no love. And so from the venerable St. Valentine, who lost his head over love, to mating birds, to romantic love advocated by the Puritans, to Victorians sending homemade cards to one another, here we are. An American spent on average $142 per person on Valentine's cards and candy and gifts. That's a few billion dollars if you do the math. $19 billion total by Americans spent on Valentine's Day. And so the business of romance is booming while the world is strewn with broken relationships. So something is wrong. Something is out of sync. Something is out of line. And we're all about romance. We're all excited about romance and candles and music and candy and gifts. Me too. Me too. I'm for that. I advocate that. You don't believe me? Read The Dancing Puritan, my blog site. Read the last 14 days. I've given 14 days of love every day. Activities for husbands and wives, couples to share together. I'm all for romance. I'm excited about it. But there's something that has to ground that. There must be a context for that. There must be a richness that grows out of Scripture that's connected to the gospel. Because as Solomon says in Ecclesiastes, as the whole message, rejoice in the wife of your youth. But we know what his whole message there is. Connected to Christ, we can do that. But severed from God, it's just emptiness and brokenness. And so the passages we read talk about blessedness, joy, permanence, and joy, enjoyment, togetherness, intoxication, lovesickness, and the gospel. That's what it's about. That's the picture. You read a book like the Song of Solomon, and one day I'll have the nerve to take you through that. But it's a song. When you read the Song of Solomon, know this, you're reading a song. It's poetry, it's music. And you make a mistake when you read the Song of Solomon if you're looking for sort of a literal picture in every poetical description that's given there, and trying to attach every symbol, every picture, every poetical phrase to a specific act or kind of intimacy. You miss the message in the song if you do that. You also miss the message in the song if you don't see any sort of literal, practical application for human love. And you see that the only thing that it's about is God and Israel, or Christ and the church. That, of course, always is the ultimate thing. It is a love song that teaches us principles about marriage. Now, here's really the key point that we'll hang our hat on. You see, we'll see it in the song in a moment. We see it in Proverbs 5:15, that godly marriage is built on, yes, Christ, the gospel, and His word, and an exclusive relationship between a man and a woman. Exclusivity. Anything that wars against exclusivity erodes the marriage, diminishes the gospel, and leads to great heartache and pain. And so in Proverbs 5:15, the scripture says, drink from your own cistern. Drink from your own cistern. One commentator put it, all of a man's intimate energy is to be directed to his wife and not outside of his marriage. If you look at the passage in Proverbs, let's go back there for a moment. Proverbs 5 and verse 15. Drink water from your own cistern, flowing water from your own well. Drink, enjoy. Should your springs be scattered, a broad stream of water in the streets, let them be for yourself alone and not for strangers with you. Let your fountain be blessed and rejoice in the wife of your youth, a lovely deer, a graceful doe. Let her breast fill you at all times with delight. Be intoxicated always in her love. And whose love? Your wife. Why should you be intoxicated, my son, with a forbidden woman? Who's a forbidden woman? Anyone that's not your wife is a forbidden woman. Anyone that is not your wife in covenant relationship is forbidden from you for the pleasures that are associated in the context of marriage. That's the forbidden woman and forbidden man. Why should you be intoxicated with a forbidden woman and embrace the bosom of an adulteress? For man's ways are before the eyes of the Lord. God sees. He ponders all his paths. The iniquities of the wicked ensnare him, and he is held fast in the cords of his sin. He dies for lack of discipline, and because of his great folly, he is led astray. And so, drink from your own cistern. All of a man or woman's intimate energy is to be directed to their spouse and nowhere else. Not outside of the marriage. Not physical or mental energy elsewhere. And we know it's mental as well, because Jesus says in Matthew 5:27-28 that even to look lustfully upon a woman is to commit adultery in one's heart. So it is not just the physical act of looking outside of marriage for intimate pleasure. It is imagining. It is mentally lusting after one who is not your spouse. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 3 and 4 says that, in essence, you belong to each other, no one else. No one else. In the Song of Solomon, if we go back there for a moment, just chapter 4 and 5, I'll just point out a couple of examples of this sort of exclusivity. In verse 16, the man speaks of, chapter 4, he speaks of my garden, speaking of his wife. In the latter part of verse 16, the woman speaks, and she says, let my beloved come to his garden. In chapter 5, he speaks, I came to my garden. And that's what 1 Corinthians 7:3-4 says, that in essence, that the man belongs to the woman and the woman belongs to the man. Both belong to the Lord. So I'm not my own. I'm not my own as a believer. Because Christ has purchased me with his own blood, and I'm not my own in the context of marriage. I belong to my wife, and she belongs to me. It's this mutual giving of yourself to one another and recognizing the exclusivity in marriage. We belong to one another and to no one else. The old commentator Charles Bridges, in his commentary on Proverbs, says, "Desire after forbidden enjoyments naturally springs from dissatisfaction with the blessings in possession. Where contentment is not found at home, one's own cistern, it will be sought for, however vainly, abroad. Conjugal love is chief among the earthly goods and mercy granted by God to his fallen and rebellious creature. Enjoy then with thanksgiving thine own, and desire not thy neighbor's well." He says that we ought to regard our spouse as a special gift from the Father's hand. A special gift. Do you treat your spouse like that? Or you're discontent for whatever the reason may be in your marriage, and you start looking elsewhere, imagining elsewhere, if I'd only married someone else, then A, B, C, or D. Regard your spouse as a special gift. Proverbs 19:14, a prudent wife is from the Lord. And then he says, cherish her with gentleness and purity. We know when Isaac took Rebekah to be his wife in Genesis 27:64, the scripture says he loved her and he was comforted after his mother's death. We know Isaac loved his mother. And when his mother was gone, he married Rebekah, and she was a comfort to him. Last night, I pulled a volume off the shelf that's about George Herbert, has some of his poetry, but the author opens up with a story of Charles and Susanna Spurgeon, who else, of course, you know, he opens it up, and he talks about how in their marriage, after the Lord's Day, after he had poured his heart out preaching, he'd come home and he would be somewhat down, somewhat discouraged. Every preacher knows the feeling. You preach and you know, preaching is like exposing yourself every week, your heart, your life, everything about you is on display for everyone to see and evaluate and discuss and think about. And pastor often goes home after preaching. He's exhausted. He's stored it up. He's poured it out. And Spurgeon was like that as well. He went home, and so in the evenings, his mind would be racing a bit. He'd be a bit anxious. He'd be somewhat depressed. And so Susanna would say to him often, "Do you want me to read to you from Master George Herbert?" And they pictured, Susanna tells the story of Charles sitting there by the fire and she on a cushion at his feet reading for an hour, until her beloved's mind was comforted and his strength had been renewed and she was a help to him like that. That's the way that Rebekah comforted Isaac. Bridges goes on to say, whatever interrupts the strictest harmony in this delicate relationship opens the door to imminent temptation. So we're talking about exclusivity here as the display of love in marriage that reflects the gospel of Christ. Christ loves His church loves her. That's an exclusive relationship built on God's particular love for His people like that that's reflected in marriage. When one of the applications for husbands love your wives as Christ loves the church is that the husband is to love his wife in a particular, unique, limited from all others way. He is to have his love focused particularly on her like Christ does the church. Just, you know, we know of God's general love for all people, but it's different than God's love for His church that He purchased in Christ. And when you read Solomon's Song, for example, and you see the man saying there, you know, out of all the women in the world, yeah, there are lots of lovely women, he might say, in the world. But you are, O most beautiful among women. Of one woman, he said, you're flawless, as he looked at her through the eyes of love. So whatever interrupts the strictest harmony in this delicate relationship opens the door to temptation. So tender, well-regulated domestic affection is the best defense against the vagrant desires of unlawful passion. Cultivating joyful exclusivity, particular love in marriage, as Christ has for the church, fights against the vagrant desires of unlawful passions. Christ's exclusivity to the church, his particular love for the church, his definite atonement for the church is reflected in a husband's love, a godly husband's love for his wife. And Christ washes and cleanses the church through his word so that we, as well as husbands, must be agents of cleansing and washing and sanctification and purity to our spouse out of devotion to Christ, enabled by the power of the gospel that delivers us from sin and takes us to heaven. And so we must catch the little foxes that spoil the vineyards, that tempt and hinder, to interrupt exclusivity in our home. Now, what those foxes could be, all sorts of things. Wandering, comparing eyes, thoughtlessness, a lack of tender care, distraction, few banqueting house experiences, considering time with spouse as unnecessary, neglecting spiritual disciplines, refusing intimacy, lack of quality face-to-face communication. Song of Solomon 2:14, let me see your face, let me hear your voice. There's this desire for face-to-face communication that goes beyond anything else. So we must cultivate exclusivity through godly desire, missing and thinking of one another when separated. Missing and thinking of one another. We should delight in our spouse like that. The Bible says that Christ delights in his church. His church is delight to delight in him. There's to be that delight from husband to wife, from wife to husband. So godly desire, there's to be sweet conversation in marriage. Sweet conversation in marriage. It's interesting to watch married couples as you're out and about, and how they can often speak so kindly, and often do speak so kindly to others, and yet so dismissively to one another. And you look at the Proverbs 5, and you look at the context of Ephesians 5, you look at the Song of Solomon, you look at the pictures of marriage we have and the church, and it's just the opposite of that. It's sort of like the scripture says that we're to do good to all people. I mean, as Christians, we have a benevolent spirit towards all people, but especially to those of the household of faith. And so in the context of marriage, you know, we should have a benevolence and a generosity towards all sorts of people. But there needs to be a distinction and a special generosity and a special distinction and a special love for the one that we're in covenant relationship with for a lifetime. And that is reflected often in our speech, the way we talk to one another. Now, what comes out of our lips reflects our hearts. What's inside of us? Where our longings are. Our contentment, as Paul says, is to be in Christ. Paul says in Philippians, I've learned to be content in all things. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And in essence, what he means by that is I can be content with plenty. I can be content with little. My contentment is in Christ. It's ultimately not in another person. It's not in financial well-being. It's not in anything but Christ. And when my contentment is in Christ alone, then I can rejoice in the Lord and do good to others, even when they may not be reciprocating, right? So I can speak sweetly even when I'm not spoken sweetly to, or we can. Sweet conversation, and then that creative communication. That creative communication, such as you find throughout the Song of Solomon, where in chapter 1, verse 16, she says, or verse 15, he says, "Behold, you are beautiful, my love." And she says, "Behold, you are handsome, my beloved, truly delightful." Christ delights to hear our voice. That's the message. That's God gave us prayer. You know, God's not in heaven needing information, needing us to clarify anything for Him. He's not impressed by, you know, our repetitious words. But what is prayer if not the heart of God calling out to His beloved children to speak to Him? He wants to hear our voices. And He wants to see us. He wants us to see us in the intimacy of prayer. There's no absence of knowledge in Christ. And so when we go to the Song, we need to constantly be beelining it back to Christ and the church and His love there. And this creative communication. This exclusivity is cultivated through godly desire, sweet conversation, creative communication. You see that throughout the Song. Through spending time together. Chapter 2, verse 4, we have the man bringing the woman. "He brought me to the banqueting house, the house of wine. And his banner over me was love." So that's we sing that in a hymn. Certainly it is true, right, that Christ delights in His people and His banner of love is over us. But it also speaks to the public relationship of a husband and wife. We talked about the couple out in public and the way they talk to one another, sort of snippy and dismissive and lack of thoughtfulness and love. But here we have a picture of the man taking the woman out for a night on the town, and it is obvious to everyone in sight, everyone who can hear, everyone who can observe the relationship. There's a big banner flying over the relationship, and it says L-O-V-E. It says, "This woman is loved. This woman is loved." And as Christians, single or married alike, we go out and we're wearing the banner of love. Let us reflect that love in all of our relationships. His banner is love. And so we see this couple spending time together in banqueting houses, and then the man calling for the woman, leaping over the mountains, bounding over the hills. Again, this is a song to be sung. This is poetic language. It is talking to us about a real relationship that points ultimately to God and His love for His people. And so the man shows up and he speaks and he says, "Arise, my love, my beautiful one, and come away. For behold, the winter is past, the rain is over, the flowers appear on the earth, the time of singing has come. The voice of the turtle dove is heard in our land. The fig tree ripens its figs. The vines are in blossom. They give forth fragrance. Arise, my beautiful one, and come away. Come away. Let me see your face. Let me hear your voice. Your voice is sweet. Your face is lovely." And then that's where they say, "Catch the little foxes that spoil the vineyards." And then, "My beloved is mine," she says, "and I'm his. He grazes among the lilies until the day breathes and the shadows flee. Turn, my beloved, be like a gazelle or a young stag on cleft mountains." Spend time joyfully together, and that gives a public testimony of love that you may have the opportunity to speak about. Let me tell you what's behind our marriage. I told you about the older couple that we had the opportunity to spend time with this week. And one of my first comments to Lori about this older couple is, you see her eyes. You know, the psalmist prays, I forget the psalm, one of our psalms from last week, the psalmist prays, Lord, put light in my eyes. He didn't want to sleep the sleep of death because he wanted to live longer so he could glorify God on the earth. Put light in my eyes. And one of the first things I commented to Lori about this lady, I said, do you see her eyes? Do you see the light in her eyes. And we watched this couple together, again, an older couple, and just the joy, the way they talked to each other, the way they talked about one another. A couple of times I was blushing to see such joy in this mature couple. This tender affection that they have for one another. The way they talked about their time together. The way they described their lives together. So the song gives us that sort of poetry that helps us to cultivate, let it distill down in our minds and into our hearts so that it becomes as natural as breathing to the Christian to display such affection one for another. So cultivating exclusivities through desire, through conversation, communication, spending time together, seeking one another out when separated due to some problem or otherwise. We see a couple of occasions in the song where that happens, chapter 3, verse 1 through 5. And so her beloved's not there. She goes after him. She goes after him. And we might make a modern application of that, or a practical application of that, that sometimes, whatever the reason may be, whatever's going on in our lives, we might be separated from one another. When that happens, go after the other. Don't let that simmer. Don't let that remain. Don't let that stay. Two Wednesday nights ago, I shared the story of Tim Keller and his wife, and in essence, how she said to him, "Unless we pray together every day, I'm not going to make it. I'm not going to make it." And so that the everyday part just sort of struck him, because he said, "Well, I'm traveling all over the place. How do we do that?" But they made a commitment that day to pray together every day. And years have passed now. They're still doing that. So when he's on the road, you know, they're doing it by phone. Sometimes they may be having to do it by email or whatever. But they're daily in contact with one. Not a day is passing that they're not in contact and not praying together in some way. That tells us that we're dependent upon God, and we've got to stay close together. Things will come in, wedge the relationship. Thank God for technology, right? So that when we do travel, there are ways that through texting and email and Skyping, there's 1,000 ways that we can stay connected in our culture. Technology can have one of two things. One, it can disconnect you. Don't you like the new thing at Chick-fil-A? We practiced it the other day. It's amazing how difficult that can be. So they got a box on the table, right? And so, you know, they encourage you, if you will put your phones in this box until your meal is over, we will give you an ice cream. That's motivation for me. That's my love language, ice cream. Even though we'd had a lot of Chick-fil-A ice cream earlier in the day, I didn't get the ice cream, but we did put our phones in the box. So last night for our Valentine's dinner at home, Lori had the Chick-fil-A box. You know, Chick-fil-A has their tentacles everywhere. You know, they're sneaking into your home, and they're influencing your wife. So watch out if you go to Chick-fil-A. And it's all good, by the way, the food and the influence. And so we had our box. We had to put our technology in. Lori commented, you know, the moment it was over, I was going for the box, and so she had to call me on that. Because, you know, I might have got a tweet. I could have got a text. I could have got an Instagram. I don't have that, but I could have gotten one. I don't even know what that is, but I know the girls have it, you know, Instagram. They Instagram Nana, you know, right? Yeah. Nana has an Instagram. And so now I'm following after Nana's lead. I've got to get me an Instagram. I could have got a Facebook message. I could have got a phone call. So technology, and you see it all the time. You see couples out, and they're both. Used to be you see couples out, and they're both reading the newspaper. Well, and they're not talking to each other. And now everybody's on the phone. Now, Lori goes to the chiropractor a lot, trying to find some relief from her injury, from her wreck. And that used to be, I used to go there sometime too. It used to be a place of community social activity. In fact, everybody, the same people gathering every week and discussing the same things all the time. Just talk, talk, talk. She said the last time she was there, she noticed, sort of dawned on her, that it was pretty quiet in there. She looked around, and everyone in the chiropractor's office was doing the same thing, and her included, by the way. They were looking at their phones, and no one was talking. That's the posture of our culture. Folks walking down the street doing this, and everywhere you go, you know, car with someone, You know, you're walking down the street, go to the restaurant. And so technology can distract us from one another, but also it can be a great tool for bringing us together, especially when we are separated. And so we love texting for that reason, able to keep up with our children better when they're gone. And, you know, quick little points of communication when a phone call might not be as efficient or effective. And so we want to find ways to spend time together like that and seek one another out when we're separated. Sometimes the separation, maybe there's a problem, maybe there's been an argument. And so what do, when there's an argument? You give, if you're dating, you give them an engagement ring. That's how you get over the argument. That's what I did. I had the engagement ring. I was planning to give it later. Lori and I had a little bit of a dispute. I said, you know, time is of the essence. So I right there, I stopped what I was doing. I got the ring. I got on my knee. I said, would you be my wife? And she said, yes, of course. And we don't remember what we were arguing over anymore. But you go after each other. You seek, you know, you don't let the sun go down on your anger, as the scripture says. You seek one another out when separated. Don't go to sleep on that. Don't let that burn and simmer. Love each other enough to go after each other when separated because of an argument or separated because of the miles, because of our work schedules and whatnot. Next, we cultivate that exclusivity not only by deepening desire, by sweet and creative communication, conversation, by spending time with one another, by seeking one another out when separated, but by cultivating the interior life of love. Cultivating the interior life of love. And Song of Solomon 3:10, on the wedding day, Solomon shows up in his chariot, the day of the gladness of his heart. That's what I always tell every young couple, this focus on this day being a day of great gladness. But what does it say about that chariot in chapter 3, verse 10? That it's inlaid with love. Inlaid with love. And so we might apply that and make application and say, focus on the interior of one's life. Where does that happen? Where's the interior developed primarily? In prayer, in scripture reading, in reading good books and listening to good messages and seeking God's face in prayer. It's cultivated in the private place, taking heed to yourself, as Paul told Timothy, and the doctrine. In doing that, you'll save yourself and those who hear you. And so you help others by taking heed to yourself, watching over your life, confessing your sin, seeking God's face. Cultivate the interior life of love. I wrote about that in the last 14 days. You can dig that section up. 7, embrace marriage as a good and glad thing. A good and glad thing. Marriage is good and glad when that is God's design. Singleness is good and glad when that is God's design. And there are benefits to both. The Apostle Paul is an example of a single man who served God joyfully and faithfully and contentedly. And we have the great stories in song and in the Old Testament as well of the patriarchs and their marriages and the joy and love that they had. Embrace marriage as a good and glad thing. Another way that we kind of cultivate that exclusivity is we take care of ourselves. We want to make sure not only that the interior life is developed, but we want to do things as best we can to enable physical health and physical beauty. And I think the song is helpful there as well. She describes him in chapter 5, his strength and his health and his vigor, his life. And she's described with her perfume and her beauty and her desirability. There's no virtue in being as unattractive as you can possibly be for the glory of God. Now, some of us, like me, we have very little to work with. But work with it. Work with it. So we see that. And we have other passages, you know, that there is a little profit It should not be the passion, the focus of our lives, but bodily exercise profits. A little, the scripture says, godliness is profitable for all things. The tenth thing is, and we looked at this a little bit earlier, chapters 4 and 5 of the song, don't storm the garden, but don't lock the garden. So the husband and wife in their relationship and intimacy with one another, they're not intruders. They should be welcomed joyfully and thoughtfully. You see that in the song. This all encourages that exclusivity that chapter 7 and verse 10 says, I am my beloved's and his desire is for me. I belong to him, he desires me, unlike he does anyone else. And then just one other thing there, chapter 12 or 11 or 10, wherever we are on this long list, tattoo your spouse on your heart. On your heart. The song, chapter 8 and verse 6, where the scripture says, set me as a seal upon your heart, as a seal upon your arm, for love is strong as death. Love is strong as death. So in the passages, we've looked at joy as a theme. Rejoice with the wife of your youth, Proverbs 5:18, being intoxicated with her love. Ecclesiastes 9:9, enjoy life with your spouse. I mean, this is a great adventure. This is a great journey. It's not all sugar, as Spurgeon said. But the sweetness will take away the sours. The sweetness of marriage will take away the sours of marriage and will sustain you through the hard times. Rejoice. Be intoxicated. Enjoy life together. How are you cultivating that? Life together. Enjoying your spouse and showing them joy even when it's not reciprocated. And the banner of love, again, the theme of joy and love and happiness in our relationships. So let me close with just a few points of practical application. Remembering we belong to God, blood bought, not our own. We belong to our spouse. We're lovers and friends. C.S. Lewis called friendship a main course in life's banquet. And we need... as the song says, you're my lover and you're my friend. This is a main course in life's banquet, not just an extra. I mean, this is the main thing. That sort of friendship. Your marriage is telling about Jesus, it's telling about the gospel. So let me just give you some counsel. This is Ray counseling you as I think of all of Scripture and I think of some of the experience that we've had over the years in relationships. Now, I'm not going to necessarily give you a verse for every one of these things, so you test what I say by Scripture. Number one, and this is fresh on my mind of late, is find a mentor. Now, this is true whether you're married or single. We need mentors in our life. We need older men helping us, guys, younger ladies. You need older women helping you. Wherever you are in your journey, you make a tragic error if you isolate yourself. You will find, as the proverb says, your own destruction if you do that. You've got to bring your life into the light of Christ and the gospel and prayer, yes, but you also have to bring your life into the light of accountability with a brother and with a sister. You need mentoring. I think we can prove that from Scripture. And so, remember a couple of years ago, a year ago, when I said, you know, I don't have a will. You guys hold me accountable to get a will. I got a will. You sent me to London so I'd get a will. I knew if I went to London, I had to get a will. And so that's what happened. So I got the will. So I made a commitment last week. And I began seeking it out. I made the first point of contact. I'm 54 years old, but I need an older, godly man in my life to help me to think about life. I need that. I had to humble myself. And I fought that idea, and you know, I'm too busy for that. It's not necessary. I don't have time for that. But I need that. someone that is joyfully, contagious, spiritually minded, and married. In my case, I need a godly man to help me to think through life. As you know, I swim in the Psalms. And I'm just going to be honest with you this morning. This is a little deviation from the norm, I know. But I often feel like David in the Psalms, Psalm 6, that he says, I'm languishing. Or he says, I'm up to my neck in water, and the waves are crashing over me, and the ground beneath me is miry. I'm sinking down as the water covers my head. And so I decided last week, and you have to hold me accountable, and I've again made the contact with the guy, that I need to seek out an older man, at least 10 years older than me. In my case, that's the way I sort of thought it through, to help me to think about life, to help me navigate things, landmines I never expected. And if you read my post from yesterday, I talk about our journey and the laughter and the tears and the challenges in marriage. It's a pretty honest post. And so I know you'll want to read that now that I've pictured it like that. But I need that. And I'm going to seek that out. I need an older man. An older father-like figure who has... You know, a lot of the guys I'm friends with, they're just like me. They're going through the same things, and we can benefit from each other. We sharpen one another. But I need more perspective than that. I need a larger perspective than that. And so I don't care how old you are. I think you need that sort of mentoring relationship. Single guys, single girls, do the same. Ladies, find older, godly, mature women. They may not necessarily have to be older in age, but they need to be deeper in maturity than you are. That's what discipleship is. I heard this 100 years ago from John MacArthur. It's always stuck in my mind. Discipleship is this. Find someone who's more mature, who's stronger, who's more glowing and growing, and I'm adding, in Christ than you are, and hitch your wagon to that person. Go to that person and say, look, will you let me hang out with you? It doesn't matter how old they are or not. Find someone. And then the other side of discipleship is find someone who's less mature than you are, who could use encouragement, use a helping hand, use some strength, and say, look, can I come alongside of you? It's mutual. Find that person. Pray. Listen, this morning, ask God to lead you to those two people. Lead you to that older, godly, joyful, contagious man or woman, and lead you to that less mature believer who needs your help and your prayers. I believe God will answer that prayer. Will you pray that? Will you ask God to lead you and help you? And then be proactive. Don't just, you know, sit in your... God may do this, but don't go home and get back in your lazy chair and wait on the doorbell to ring. That may happen, but don't wait. Get busy. Ladies, Titus 2. Find an older woman who will teach you how to be a homemaker, how to love your husband, love your children. Ecclesiastes 4, 9 through 12, two are better than one. We know about David and Jonathan's friendship. Ralph Earl Davis, a great commentator, said, in David's disintegrating world, there was still one place of sanity, one refuge still intact, Jonathan. Jonathan. Maybe you feel like your world is disintegrating. Do you have a friend like that? That you can bear all. And are you willing to humble yourself? Guys, especially you. Are you willing to humble yourself and say, I need help. I need help. Do that. So find a mentor. The second practical point of help I want to give you this is be intentional in your relationships. Your friendships, your church, your marriage. Parents, the best gift that you can give to your children is a happy, spirit-filled, contagious, joyful marriage connected to a local church. That's a good gift. And so I want to challenge you. Read the Scripture and pray together. Read and pray together. Read the Bible. pray together, read books together. One of the things that Lori and I talked about, we had sort of a meeting of the marriage last week, talked about some things. As I said, this is what I want us to do for the rest of our marriage. I want us at least once a year. I teach marriage retreats. I lead marriage workshops. I do marriage seminars. I preach marriage sermons. But I don't ever sit under that myself. And so for the rest of our marriage, I said, this is what I want us to do every year. I want us to go to a marriage retreat. I want us to listen. I want us to learn. And I want us to grow together. And you know what? I was doing a retreat in Florida a couple of years ago. And this elderly couple, been married forever. And that's what they told us. They said, we go to a marriage retreat every year. And so here they are late in life, in their 80s, I think, and they're still going to marriage retreats. That's beautiful. That's making an investment, an intentional investment in your marriage. And so that retreat can happen in rotating years. One year, it may be just you and your spouse and your books and your journals, and you go off alone and you pray about individually and together, think about, talk about your marriage. And then the next year, you actually go to a retreat where there's teaching and there are other couples and there's conference. I mean, however you think is best. I know we're keeping our grandchildren, so Rachel and Adrian can listen to Matt Chandler's own simulcast marriage retreat. They sent it out to you. That's an option for you as well to go to the retreat. Now, not all marriage retreats are created equal. You're going to hear some things. Sometimes you got to chew the meat and spit out the bones. But I'm willing to go to a marriage retreat where the folks are godly and they love the Scripture, and they may not be perfect. Their theology may not be as precise as I imagine mine to be. But I know they love Christ. I know they love His Word. I know they're invested in marriage. And I'm willing to go and learn. That's what I want to do the rest of my marriage together. Would you guys do that? Or think about that. It's you and your spouse pulling away for the rest of your life and spending those days together. Let me say this to you, to get help now. If there's some situations where husband and wife are not even talking to each other, and the marriage is so fractured and so broken, and everybody keeps hoping, well, tomorrow will be better, next week will be different. This is too important. This is about Christ and the church. Get help now. We can send you to the Biblical Counseling Center in Peachtree City. I know those folks will make an exception for me. They'll help you. I know one of the elders. I can get you in. Come see me. I'll connect you somewhere. Maybe you need to go to some marriage intensive somewhere. You know, marriage intensive, the places where the husband and wife show up, they're not talking to one another, not even staying in the same room together. And so they go to these places, they have a room on this end, a room on this end, a living room in the middle, and they can lock their doors and stay put. And but they show up at meals together with folks that counsel, encourage, and instruct them from the Scripture. Don't delay. This is about Christ and the church. It's about your children. It's about your church. So find a mentor, attend. Pull away regularly together. Find a way to do that. It's not an option. You can't say, well, I would if I wasn't so busy. I think I'm a pretty busy guy myself. And it's a necessity. Let me encourage you with this, to connected to that, but attend church together regularly. Learn in community. But just be connected into a local band of brothers, band of sisters. I told another person this week who I met, not here in our church, but out and about, who said, I love Christ, I love the Scripture, but I'm not connected anywhere. I'm just here and here and there. I said, look, guys, and I'm just, as I get older, I become more plain, direct. I mean, what do we have to lose? Life is short, right? I said, you need to stop going church to church and find you the best imperfect church that you can find and join that church. Join that church. And this guy was got a young family, children, and wants to follow Christ, but he's trying to do it apart from the church. You need that band of brothers and sisters. Delight in your spouse, but realize that your marriage is about another marriage. And my final bit of counsel to you is to study marriage, whether you're single or whether you're married. Even if it doesn't apply to you specifically now, or maybe you have a gift of singleness and it will never apply to you in a personal getting married to another person kind of way, remember the marriage behind the marriage. Study what the Scripture teaches about marriage and read great books on marriage. And make that a part of your journey. Our lives together one day will end as our friends out on a boating trip, cardiac arrest. Sarah tells me number one cause of death, right? So that's why she's in the top there. That's why she's going to work for Nurse in the Word for life. She's going to follow me, my personal assistant, for the rest of my life, because oftentimes cardiac arrest can be stopped if you have someone that knows CPR. That's all. And there's a story of a local situation here where somebody had a cardiac arrest. The 911 is called. The ambulance shows up. There's a group of people standing around looking at the person in cardiac arrest. Nobody knew or felt confident about CPR. And you can save a life with chest compressions. Often. So this person died. And you're going to die. And there's going to come a day that you're going to be separated. So let me close with this story, and I'm done. Talked too much this morning. In 1895, 3 years after Spurgeon died, Susanna wrote, "God comforted me in my affliction, and in His wondrous pity and compassion, He uplifted me from the sorrow of my loss into the joyful hope of eternal reunion in the land that knows no death." She described her journey with Charles as, quote, "two pilgrims treading this highway of life together, hand in hand, heart linked to heart." That's a good picture of marriage. She describes their trials together as rivers to ford and mountains to cross and fierce enemies to fight and many dangers to go through. When you got premarital counseling, did your counselor tell you that? Well, let me tell you what's about to happen to you. You've got rivers to ford, mountains to cross, enemies to fight, and dangers to go through. Probably you might not have heard that, but it's true, isn't it? Though in the midst of their challenges, she said that their God was watchful and their deliverer unfailing, and their journey was one of mostly singing. Singing through trials, through rivers to ford, mountains to cross, enemies to fight, and dangers. Singing? That's what Susanna said. However, eventually they came to a place on the road where two ways met, and here, amidst the terrors of the storm, such as they had never before encountered, they parted company. The one being caught up to the invisible glory, the other battered and bruised by the awful tempest, henceforth toiling along the road alone. Susanna knew God was her helper. The goodness and mercy, which so many years had followed the two travelers, did not leave the solitary one, but rather the Lord led on softly, and chose green pastures for the tired feet and still waters for the solace and refreshment of his trembling child. A year after Spurgeon died, Susanna described a tender scene as she wrote from her husband's study. She says, "I'm writing in my husband's study where he thought and prayed and wrote. Each inch of this place is sacred ground. Everything remains precisely as he left it. His books, now my most precious possessions, stand in shining rows upon the shelves in exactly the order in which he placed them. And one might almost fancy the room was ready and waiting for its master. But oh, that empty chair, that great portrait over the door, the strange solemn silence which pervades the place now that he is no longer on earth. I kneel sometimes by his chair, and laying my head upon the cushion arms which so longly supported his dear form, I pour out my grief before the Lord and tell him again that though I am left alone, yet I know he hath done all things well. Then wandering from room to room, looking with tear-dimmed eyes at the home treasures my dear one loved and admired, almost expecting to hear the sound of his footsteps behind me and the sweet tones of his tender voice and loving greeting, I have alas to realize afresh how true were King David's words when he said in his sorrow, I shall go to him, but he shall not return to me. What a love story. But the reason Susanna could talk like that through her tears is because of another marriage. A marriage with Christ. A love that she knew of her Lord. And though her earthly companion and partner and fellow traveler, that she had forded the rivers and climbed the mountains and faced the enemies and walked through dangers with, was gone. She knew what David knew in Psalm 27, that even if mother and father forsake me, the Lord will take me up. While you live with your partner on earth and while you study marriage as a single person on this earth, remember this. Remember the marriage behind marriage. And cultivate joy and happiness and sweetness. Why not? Why not? Why be bitter with your spouse? Why be angry in your relationships? Why withhold love from an imperfect sinner like you? Remember the gospel. When you're tempted to withhold love and expect perfection from your spouse, you're misunderstanding the gospel. There's only one Savior, and that's Christ. There's only one perfect one, and that's Jesus. Think of how much He has forgiven you. If you understand that, and that churns around in your heart, why in the world would you withhold love and forgiveness and sweetness and patience and understanding from your spouse? Why would you do that? Go back to the gospel. See the marriage behind the marriage. Father, thank you for your word and your people. Lord, we could not know anything about love by simply looking at two human beings, except that God so loved us that He sent His Son. We know love, John says, because He's first loved us and displayed that love and stretching out His arms and dying on the cross for sinners. Lord, help us to know that love. Help us to love one another, our friends, our fellow church members, our work associates, our neighbors. Help us to have big, generous hearts towards all people. And for those of us who are married, Lord, help us to especially love one another, to humble ourselves and say, hey, I need some help. I'm going to be intentional about our marriage. Pray for me. And take one another by the hand as long as we have a hand to hold on this earthly journey, but with our hearts anchored firmly in heaven with Christ. Lord, bring sinners to the Savior this morning. Bring healing to broken people. Bring renewed energy to folks who may have lost hope and maybe the glow has left their eyes under the cares of life. Bring hope, Lord, that through Christ, not only can marriage and relationships be survival, they can be joyful. And help us to see beyond our immediate comforts to what our relationships are ultimately pointing to. And help us then, knowing that, having that vision, to display mind, attitude, and words the love of Christ for His church. We commit all of this into your hands, and we pray in Jesus' name.